now to introduce today's program here in the Hall of Philosophy and to continue our amazing week on the theme of reclaiming the Bible in a non-religious world. As you well know, because you were here yesterday, this week's distinguished lecturer is the Right Reverend John Shelby Spong, the retired Episcopal Bishop of Newark, prolific author, and as you know now why, he is an in-demand speaker. Today he will speak on the topic of the prophets, not predictors of the future, but change agents. Bishop Spong, you know that we are very, very grateful for your presence here, and I believe this remarkable audience that has gathered will tell you that they also agree. You will all be pleased to know that Bishop Spong will do a book signing on Wednesday, right across the way on the porch of the Hall of Missions. And seated before me today, in the special place where he should be, is Warren Martin. And so we say again to Warren, especially to Warren, who in honor of his wife Eileen, has established a lectureship for emerging studies in Bible and theology. And that brings the support for this week's lecture series. And again, Warren, thank you so very, very much. Join me now in welcoming John Spong.
It doesn't matter. Either way. Thank you very much. I'm glad you're back. I love to hear myself introduced. Whether it's true or not is beside the point. I have one thing that makes me unusual and special, and that's I'm Christine's husband. That's all that really matters to me. Well, I hope that since yesterday's class, you've had a chance to read the entire Bible. In order to do a proper preparation, I hope you slept well last night, and I hope you all dreamed of your mother-in-law. Does God change? Can God change? If God is defined as that which is ultimate, that which embodies perfection, then the answer is clearly no. And there are many religious expressions that yearn for God not to ever change. O thou who changeth not, abide with me. The Epistle to the Hebrews describes an unchanging Jesus. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But the fact is that the human understanding of God is always changing. It is always evolving. It is always adapting. If you make a study of the history of human religion, you will find that the human spirit has understood God in a wide variety of ways. We can chart the major ones quickly. It was first animism, and then fertility cults, and then tribal gods, and then the gods of the Olympus, a god for almost everything. And then there was the emerging monotheism. But even monotheism in our world today is seriously debated. There are sort of three competing monotheistic deities in our world. One is the God of the West, the Judeo-Christian God. One is the God of the Middle East, Allah of Islam. And one is the God of the Far East, the Buddhists, the Hindus, the Sikhs, the Jains. All claim to believe in one God, but they define that God in very distinctly different ways. So there's a question, does any person ever exhaust the meaning of God in his or her own understanding? Does any religion ever exhaust the meaning of God in its understanding? The fact is, the concept of God changes very dramatically, even in the pages of Holy Scripture, which makes it really difficult for fundamentalists. Because if you literalize the Scriptures and find that even the concept of God changes, somehow you've got to change along with it. When the Bible opens, it opens in a period of human history that would be called tribal religion. The God of the Hebrews was a tribal deity. There's a wonderful story in the Bible about a showdown at Mount Carmel between the prophet Elijah, who represented the God of the Jews, and the prophets of Baal, who represented the god and goddesses of the fertility cults of the Canaanite people. It's a story of a struggle between two competing understandings of God. But the fact is that the biblical story opens in tribal religion. And there are two things that are always true about a tribal deity. First, the tribal deity always has a chosen people. And secondly, the tribal deity always hates everybody that the chosen people hate. And those two go together. For if you and your people are God's chosen, then you have defined all people who are not part of you and your people as God's unchosen. And there's a very short line between thinking of them as God's unchosen and thinking of them as God's rejected or God's hated. And if you can convince yourself that God hates everybody you hate, it justifies almost anything you want to do. And history is replete with that kind of God understanding. So when we read the book of Exodus, we see the tribal God of the Jewish people at work. And one of the marks of that tribal God is that that tribal God hates the Egyptians. They have enslaved God's chosen people. So this God decides to attack the Egyptians with vengeance and with power. We call that the story of the plagues. God hits the Egyptians up one side and down the other. The Nile River turns to blood. The fish all die. The frogs come out of the water and begin to go all over the land in everybody's bedroom and kitchen and living room. You cannot take a step without stepping on frogs. And then the locusts swarm. And then they develop a sickness among the cows of Egypt, only the Egyptian cows. The Jewish cows don't ever seem to get sick. It's probably the first instance of mad cow disease. And then there come boils on the Egyptian people. And then hailstones, big as golf balls. And then darkness. Plague after plague after plague. God really hates the Egyptians. But even that's a rather strange view of God, for if God is all-powerful, why did it take so many plagues? Why didn't just one do it? It's strangely illogical. But the fact is, if you read the text very clearly, very carefully, you'll see that on several occasions the Pharaoh says, "Enough, Moses, enough, I'll let your people go, call off your God." And so Moses prepares for the Exodus. And then the Bible says, God hardened the Pharaoh's heart because God wanted to hit him one more time. A strange primitive view of God. And then there's the last plague. The plague that took place in the middle of the night when the angel of death was sent throughout all the land of Egypt. And the purpose was to kill. Let me make it emotional. The purpose was to murder the firstborn male in every Egyptian household. Raise your hands, those of you who are firstborn males. I want you to listen to this story existentially. On On that night, the Hebrew people make their escape. And according to the story, they head toward the Red Sea. But God is not through with these Egyptians. God splits the waters of the Red Sea, and everybody knows that, not because you've read the Bible, but because you've watched Cecil B. DeMille's dreadful movie. But he splits the waters only to save the Hebrew people. And then as soon as they've passed through, God allows the waters to flow full again and drowns all the Egyptian people. And finally, God is portrayed on the other side of the river as rejoicing in the death of all the Egyptians. That's a rather tough view of God if you happen to be an Egyptian. But see, nobody reads the scriptures from an Egyptian perspective. That isn't the tribe telling the story. And as you go on through the pages of the Bible, it doesn't get a lot better. The same tribal God is operating in the book of Joshua. Joshua is at war with the people of Ammon. And Joshua has defeated the Ammonites in battle, and they're in full rout, but the sun begins to go down. And so Joshua prays to God, and God stops the sun in the sky for the sole reason of giving more daylight for Joshua to slaughter more of his enemies. That's a strange reason to start daylight saving time. You keep reading the story, and you come to the book of Samuel. And in the book of Samuel, the prophet Samuel orders King Saul in the name of God to go to war against the Amalekites. And in that war, Samuel says, you are to commit genocide. You are to kill every man, every woman, every child, every suckling, every ox, and every ass among the Amalekites. God ordering genocide. Tribal religion is part of human development. It's part of our history. It's part of the Bible. And yet, if you read that entire book, you will discover that this God changes dramatically. The same God who sends plagues on the Egyptians and stops the sun in the sky to kill more Amorites and calls for the genocide of the Amalekites is also quoted as having said, you are to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. The same God speaks to one of the prophets and says, have we not all one Father? Has not God created us all? That same God says, you are to love your enemies. You are to bless those who persecute you. Now, the question I want to pose with you this morning is, how do we get from this tribal, vindictive portrait of God to the God who is the universal presence of love and justice? For that's the story of the Hebrew Scriptures. This afternoon, I want to look briefly at what I would call the change agents. They are always the prophets. The prophets didn't think of themselves as predictors of future events. They thought of themselves as breaking people into a new awareness of the meaning of the holy. The Hebrew Scriptures contain 16 books that are called the books of the prophets. The Christians call them the major prophets and the minor prophets, but that's based on length, not on quality. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel are longer. They are the majors. And the other 12, the Jewish people call simply the book of the 12. Christians call them the minor prophets. And most of us are wonderfully ignorant of the message of any of those tiny little books. If I were to ask you to tell me the major teaching in the book of Obadiah, How many of you could respond? Or Zephaniah? I wish I had time to do all 16. I'm not sure I have time even to do the 4 I've picked. And that's easy because if I don't have time, I'll just drop one of them. They are remarkable voices out of a remarkable people. The prophets show the transforming power and the evolving strength of the human search for the meaning and the understanding of God. I'm convinced that the prophets are unique to the Jewish people. I do not see anything comparable in the national life of any other people in the history of the human race. Only the Jews produced the prophets. And I think we need to bow deeply before them in gratitude. So let me, using some creative storytelling imagination, tell you the story of 4 of these, quote, minor prophets. Let me start with Hosea. The biographical data in the book of Hosea is very brief. We're told that Hosea marries the daughter of a Jewish merchant named Diblaine. She's later described as a prostitute. They are the parents of 3 children to whom they give very peculiar names. And at the end of the book, Hosea buys his wife from a slave market for 15 pieces of silver. And so you take that bare bones of an outline and you try to recreate the story. Hosea was an older man, a holy man, a sedate man. His bride, whose name was Gomer, not to be confused with Gomer Pyle, she was a person of exquisite youthful beauty. She had flashing eyes and dancing feet. She was the life of every party. The party didn't really start until Gomer arrived, and the party ended quickly when Gomer left, and so people wondered about this match. How would the sedate older Hosea relate to this charming, somewhat frivolous, and beautiful woman? Well, it went quite well for a while. Hosea actually got a new burst on life. He was proud of his new and beautiful bride. But they went to the parties every night because they were part of the Jewish jet set. And Gomer was clearly the star. So night after night, they were on the party trail. And there came a time when Hosea just didn't want to keep going out every night, and so they worked out a compromise. On some of the parties, Hosea would leave early, and Gomer would return with her friends, a rather dangerous practice in a patriarchal world. And later, Hosea wouldn't go out at all, and so Gomer would go to the parties with her friends and return with her friends, even a more dangerous practice in that patriarchal world. But perhaps it extended their marriage. But then the night came when Gomer did not return home. And Hosea was frantic, and he searched for her everywhere, and he could find no trace of her. It was as if she had disappeared from the face of the earth. And days passed, and weeks passed, and months passed, and his search turned up nothing. And so after a while, the frenzy of the search began to decline, and Hosea took it sort of day by day. In the meanwhile, Gomer was on the fast track. She had become the favorite plaything for the jet set. And that went on for months, it went on for years, until the inevitable began to happen. Gomer looked in the mirror one day and saw crow's feet on each side of her eyes. She suddenly began to sag in places she had never sagged before. And after a while, the jet set found a younger model. And Gomer's descent began to be apparent. From the favorite plaything of the jet set, she became the favorite plaything of anybody who wanted a plaything. But the encroachment of age continued to make itself manifest. I suppose that was in the period of time when people thought beauty had to be equated with youth. They didn't understand that beauty and character and value all mold themselves into one special person. That's why Christine is the most beautiful woman in the world. But they were not happy with just an aging Gomer. And so she suddenly had no more life with those who just needed a plaything. So she descended to the next level and she became a prostitute. But even a prostitute has got to sell something. A prostitute's got to have some attractiveness. And after a while, she had no customers. And so she descended to the next level. And she became a slave. She sold what she had to sell in service for her keep. And all the while, Hosea searched for her. And one day he came upon a slave sale in the heart of a town. With the usual riffraff around, commenting on the human bondage that was about to be offered. And onto the slave block, the slave master lifted a battered-looking old woman with matted hair and bloodshot eyes. And the riffraff set up a howl. Who would pay anything for that old bag? But Hosea recognized that as Gomer. And so in a very clear voice, he shouted, 15 pieces of silver. And the crowd was hushed. That was the price of a young, strong male slave. What incredible fool would pay that kind of price for this woman who should have been a throw-in on some other sale, if nothing else? And so it was Hosea who received the riffraff's comments as he walked through the crowd, paid the amount of money, took Gomer by the hand, and led her back to his home, not as his slave, but he installed her into the place of honor as the wife and mistress of his household. And it was out of that experience that Hosea came to a whole new understanding of God. He looked at the relationship between the Hebrew people and God. And the Hebrew people had, in Hosea's words, gone a-whoring after false gods, and God had loved them still. And no matter what it was that Gomer had done, Hosea found he loved her still. And it was out of that experience that he came to a whole new understanding of God. And Hosea redefined God as love. And then he wrote down his story. He was not writing the word of God. He was not writing sacred scripture. He was writing the words of Hosea. But over the years, people heard in the words of Hosea the word of God. And so someone at some time made the decision to incorporate Hosea into the sacred text of the Jewish people. And the tribal God of the past was transformed into the God of infinite love. The God who proclaimed that there is nothing you can ever do or be that will finally separate you from the love of God. It was a quantum leap forward. And then there was Amos. Amos was a shepherd and a keeper of sycamore trees, neither of which profession demanded great credentials. He was a simple man. I picture him with bibbed overalls, a wide hat, a corncob pipe and a piece of hay between his teeth, which had a wide space between the front two. But there's something that burned in this prophet. When he looked out, or at this man, he didn't know he was a prophet, he looked out upon his land and he saw an enormous split between the way people worshiped and the way people lived. And this dichotomy burned within him. And he felt compelled to leave his sycamore trees in the village of Tekoa, just outside Jerusalem, to go to one of the principal chapels and holy places of the Jewish nation, the place at Bethel, and there to somehow make his witness. But how does a country bumpkin with a twangy accent go into the heart of the king's chapel and command attention? Hosea made the trip, and he might not have been well educated, but he had a lot of street smarts. And so he got into the holy shrines, and he turned his soapbox up, and he got on top of his soapbox, and he began to seduce the crowd. And he seduced them by saying, "If you gather around here, friends, I'll tell you all about the sins of your enemies and neighbors." Well, everybody likes to hear that. You know, anybody can go into Manhattan today and say, "Come around here and I'll tell you about the sins of everybody that lives on Long Island." You'll get a crowd. And when you work over Long Island, you can go to Staten Island, then you can go to Westchester, and then you go to the Bronx. And you can always save the worst for last. That would be New Jersey in the minds of most New York people. So Amos, on his soapbox, started talking about the sins of the Edomites, and the crowd grew. And then he talked about the sins of the Moabites, and the crowd grew. And he talked about the sins of the people in Gaza, and the crowd grew. And with every new people that he attacked, the crowd got bigger and bigger. And they began to encourage him, "You tell him, preacher." And then he said, "Now I want to tell you about your nearest neighbors and the ones you like least of all." And that would be the Jewish nation to the south. He was in the Jewish nation to the north. He was in the northern kingdom. And you always have your deepest rivalry with the person or school or nation that you are the closest to. I have daughters that went to the University of Virginia. I have a grandson that goes to Virginia Tech. The two hate each other. All the jokes are about the other. Do you know why the homecoming queen at Virginia Tech? No, I've started that one wrong. Do you know why they have artificial turf at the football field at Virginia Tech? It's because the homecoming queen ate all the grass. Let me tell you, that'll work in Michigan with Michigan State, Illinois and Purdue, North Carolina and Duke. Well, the northern Jews felt particularly competitive with the southern Jews. And so the crowd got even bigger, and he raked over the Jews of Jerusalem with a fine-tooth comb. And then he had everybody's attention. And then he said, "Now, if you'll be quiet, I'm going to tell you about the worst people of all." And they could hardly wait. And he started talking about them. They were stunned. They were stunned into silence until he was far enough in that his message was about. He said, "All of you people gather in your finery and you worship and you don't even notice the poor and the lepers that are all around you." And he said, "Do you not know that worship is nothing but human justice being offered to God? And do you not know that human justice is nothing but divine worship being lived out? And if you ever separate worship from justice, you have become an idolater." Well, that wasn't popular. So they shut him up and they ran him out of town. They got the local priest to come out and tell him that he just couldn't speak there. He had to go back down south where people would listen to him. And so Amos retreated to Tekoa. And he wrote out his understanding of the God of justice. And somebody later decided that they heard the words of God in the words of Amos. And so his words were attached to the sacred story of the Jewish people. And God had been redefined as love by Hosea, as justice by Amos. And then there was Jonah. Alan Jones talked about Jonah earlier this week and almost ruined this lecture. Jonah is not about a prophet named Jonah who is real. Jonah is a story, a mythological story, written in a particular time of Jewish history. They had just come back from the exile. They were trying to understand why God could allow the chosen people to be defeated in battle and exile for two generations. What had they done? And finally it dawned on them that maybe they had a responsibility to keep the covenant, and because they had not kept the covenant properly, God was punishing them. But that meant they were criticizing their own parents and grandparents and great-grandparents. And then someone hit on the proper solution. You know, some of our Jewish forebears, back before the fall to the Babylonians, they had married Gentile wives, pagan wives. They had corrupted the purity of the Jewish nation, and they had brought strange religious ideas, and they had corrupted the purity of Jewish religion. And if we don't want defeat and exile to happen again, we're going to have to purge the Jewish nation of all foreign elements. So anyone who was married to a Gentile or any children born of a mixed marriage had to be banished from the land. It was a kind of Jewish period of Joseph McCarthy. Everybody's going to be pure. And as they were knocking on the doors in the middle of the night to determine the proper bloodlines, nobody could object, because to object meant, in the common wisdom of that day, that you were willing for the nation to undergo defeat and exile again. And so one lone Jewish man, probably, could have been a woman, but women weren't allowed to learn to write in those days, very many cases. So we assume he was a man. He repaired to his home, took out his quill, and wrote an anonymous story that appeared on the streets of Jerusalem at just about the time they were purging the families and splitting husbands and wives and parents and children. And this was the story he wrote. Once upon a time, there was a prophet in the land of the Jewish people whose name was Jonah. And God said to Jonah, "Jonah, I want you to go preach to the people of Nineveh." And Jonah said, "Nineveh? God, you must be mistaken. Those people are Gentiles. They're Goyim. Why in the world would you want me to speak to the people of Nineveh?" God said, "Nevertheless, Jonah, I want you to go." And what do you do when an authority of great power asks you to do something you really don't want to do? Well, we all know how to deal with that. Children know how to deal with their parents. Pupils know how to deal with their students. Employees know how to deal with their employers. And clergy know how to deal with their bishops. The first line of defense when you're told by an authority figure to do what you don't want to do is that you say yes, but you mean no. That's what Jonah did. He said, "Okay, I'll go." So he went down to the seaport and he booked passage on a ship to Tarshish, the exact opposite direction. "I'm saving God from a terrible mistake," he said. So Jonah goes down to his stateroom, opens up his bag, puts on his Bermuda shorts, pulls out the magazine section of the New York Times, goes on top, gets in one of those deck chairs, puts on his dark glasses, and prepares to enjoy his journey into the Mediterranean. And all goes very well for a few minutes. And then a very dark cloud appeared just above the little boat. To the left and the right of that cloud was clear sky. But if you're writing the story, you can put a dark cloud anywhere you want. So the dark cloud shattered the boat, and the captain noticed this strange cloud, particularly when it began to be the place from which thunder and lightning emerged, and then torrential rain. So the captain steered the ship to the left, and the little cloud turned and followed the ship to the left. And then the captain turned the ship to the right, and the little cloud followed the ship to the right. And the captain drew the obvious conclusion: somebody up there doesn't like somebody down here. And so he decided to find out who that was, and by a perfectly scientific method, he drew straws. And the straw or lot fell on Jonah. "What is this you have done?" the captain said. And Jonah said, "Well, God did tell me to go preach to those dreadful people in Nineveh. But I couldn't believe that God meant that, so I decided to go to Tarshish instead and save God from a terrible mistake. The captain was just enough prejudiced to understand that, and he said, well, we'll try to ride out this storm, Jonah. But then there was a crack of lightning and a blast of thunder, and a wave came up over the boat, and Jonah's deck chair slid from one end to the other. He had to hold on to the guardrail, and when the captain saw that, he said, Jonah, when it comes down to a choice between your security and my security, I vote for me. You got to go. To recall three deckhands. And they all came, and on three, they swung old Jonah over the rail. But God had planned for this moment, says this storyteller, by creating a great fish. The word whale never occurs in that story. God created this great fish, and with his great mouth, he had it open, and Jonah never touched the water. He went right into the mouth of the great fish, and the mouth closed, and he found himself living in a new but rather confining Mediterranean condominium. And the story says he was there for 3 days and three nights, and Jonah seemed to have a remarkable ability to adjust. You can see him hanging curtains, rearranging the furniture. But then after a while, even the fish couldn't stand him. I think he smoked. Anyway, the fish decided to have a primeval belch. It takes a lot of talent to work belch into a lecture. And Jonah got thrown up. But he landed on a tiny little sand spit in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea. But if you're writing this story, you can put a little sand spit anywhere you want. He was there on the sand spit, sort of getting the water out of his head. And he heard this voice saying, Jonah, how would you like to go preach to the people of Nineveh? And Jonah said, okay, God, I'll go. You're making a mistake, but I'll go. And in one verse, Jonah's in Nineveh. But you don't need to waste a lot of time on travel details that don't matter if you're writing this story. But Jonah wasn't through his rebellion. If saying yes and meaning no doesn't work with authority figures, you try another method. It's what I call the Frank Sinatra method. Oh, I'll do it, God, but I'll do it my way. So Jonah was going to obey the letter of the law. He was going to preach to the people of Nineveh, but he was going to preach by muttering under his breath, and he was going to preach only in the back alleys and back streets where no one would hear him. But to his utter amazement, everybody heard, and people came piling out of their high-rises and into the streets and tearing their clothes and beating their breasts and asking for mercy. Jonah was the most successful evangelist in the history of the world. Jerry Falwell would eat his heart out for such success. And Jonah was angry. I told you, God. I know what you'll do. These wretched people, they're begging for forgiveness, and you will forgive them. So Jonah stormed out of town with the revival still in action. He went outside the walls of the city where he could hear the sounds of Sweet Hour of Prayer and What a Friend We Have in Jesus coming from the revival. And he sulked. And God was strangely silent. And night fell. And Jonah went to sleep. And that night God caused a tree to rise up where Jonah was. It had thick bark and heavy foliage. And the next day God was still angry, anxious, absent. But Jonah found protection from the biting wind of the desert in the trunk of that tree. And he found relief from the heat of the sun in the foliage of that tree. And Jonah loved that tree with passion. And God was still absent. And the night fell, and Jonah went to sleep again. And that night, according to the story, God caused a worm, or created a worm, it would bore into the bark of the tree and eat its foliage. And during the night, that tree was reduced to a small pile of sawdust. And Jonah waked up the next morning. He looked for his tree, and it was gone. And Jonah was inconsolable. His grief, his bereavement were overwhelming. And finally, God broke God's silence. And God said, Jonah, Isn't it rather remarkable that you can have all of that feeling for a tree? Not just an ordinary tree, it was really a weed, Jonah. It came up in one night and disappeared in the next. And you can't bring yourself to have any feeling, any empathy for 120,000 people who live in Nineveh, to say nothing of their cattle. Jonah, do you not know that the love of God goes beyond the boundaries of your love? And that's where the book of Jonah ends. And that little prophet struck a blow against that kind of prejudice that marks all people and apparently all religious people even more deeply. What prejudice really assumes is that God cannot love beyond the boundaries of your love. And so it's okay for you to put boundaries on your love and to have some people who are outside those boundaries, some people for whom you have no responsibility. But Jonah says there are no boundaries. Jonah says that all prejudice is outside the bounds of the love of God, and God was redefined by Jonah. And then finally there was Malachi. That was not even his name. Malachi was a Hebrew word which means my messenger. The prime minister of Iraq today is named Maliki. That's Malachi, my messenger. And it was Malachi the prophet who had an insight into God that transformed the old tribal mentality. It was Malachi who heard God saying, "Have we not all one Father? Has not God created us all?" It was Malachi who said, "From the rising of the sun to its setting, God's name shall be great among the Gentiles. And in every nation, incense shall be offered unto my name." And in the writings of the prophet Malachi, the tribal God became born to a universal understanding. Hosea transformed God into love. Amos transformed God into justice. Jonah put an end to the possibility that any human prejudice could be rooted in the will of God. And Malachi told us all that God was universal. A universal God is beyond the gods of any religious system. Have we not all one Father? Has not God created us all? What I want you to understand is by the time the scriptures of the Hebrew people came to their biblical conclusion, the Jewish understanding of God had changed dramatically, powerfully. And Judaism was then able to produce another prophet. He had a Jewish name, it was Yeshua. He was also called Joshua. When he got translated into Greek, it was called Jesus, and it became Jesus in English. And this prophet would build upon that Jewish foundation, that Jewish growing understanding of God. Please remember that Jesus was a Jew. Please remember that Judaism was the womb in which we Christians were born. Please remember that the followers of Jesus did not leave the synagogue until around the year 88 of this common era, which would have been 58 years after the crucifixion. We are the products of the Jewish nation, the Jewish womb, the Jewish religion. The only scriptures Jesus of Nazareth ever knew about were what we call the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament. The only hymn book that Jesus of Nazareth ever used was what we call the Book of Psalms. He was in the prophetic tradition. And what I will do with you tomorrow, if you're kind enough to return, is that I'll take you into the gospel we call Matthew. And I chose that because it's the most deeply Jewish gospel of the four. It's a gospel that opens with 17 strange verses. They are the most boring verses in the entire Bible. Matthew 1, 1 through 17 makes the book of Leviticus read like Charles Dickens. But they represent a new step in the evolution of the human understanding of God. And they represent a life in which a new consciousness breaks through the barriers of the old mentality. And it is a continuous story. So I hope you will join us then at the same time and the same station. Thank you very much. We have about 10, 15 minutes. I'd be glad to entertain questions. I like to follow the same rule that every other question comes from a woman. I like to start with a woman because women have seldom been first in anything the church has ever done. And if we have to quit with a woman, I don't mind that because it'd be the only time in Christian history that a woman got a slight advantage. I'd like, if you're willing to do so, for you to write your questions out and give them to me or to give them to Joan or give them to my wife or to give them to anybody who looks official, because I'd like to use those questions in my column that I write once a week. One part of that column every week is a question and answer from somewhere in my lecturing audience or reading audience. So I will now recognize the first lady who approaches the first microphone. Here she comes. Thank you.
You said yesterday that the Virgin Mary became the ideal for women, and Mary Magdalene became the antithesis, the prostitute. Given that Mary of Magdala is identified in all four Gospels as the one who assumed the responsibility for going to the tomb on the third day to check the body of Jesus, to anoint the body of Jesus, a responsibility that in that culture was assigned to the spouse, do you think it possible that Mary Magdalene was both the first among the apostles and the wife of Jesus?
Well, that's a good question. Let me challenge just one part of your preamble. I don't think I said that she was the ideal woman for women. I think she's the ideal woman for men who created that image.
Yes.
The only way I know how to answer that question briefly, and that's important, is to say that keep in mind that whether we're talking about Mary, the mother of Jesus, or Mary Magdalene, and I don't think that means of Magdala, but that's another issue, we're talking about something that's written 40 to 70 years after the story of Jesus, and it's written in Greek, a language Jesus never spoke. So a lot of interpretation has gone on before that first story is written down. If you look at the biblical story carefully, you'll find that Magdalene is actually the more important woman in the Jesus story in the first three Gospels. Mary hardly appears in the first Gospel, Mark, and when she appears, it's rather negative. She appears in chapter 3 and in chapter 6. And she thinks Jesus is out of his mind, and so she and his brothers go to take him away. He's become a kind of public embarrassment. She's named Mary only one time in the first gospel, and that's from a voice in the crowd. And the voice in the crowd says, in a rather hostile manner, is not this, speaking of Jesus, is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary? Notice Jesus is the carpenter in that first episode, first mention. And Jesus is called the son of Mary, and if you call a Jewish man, a grown man in the first century, the son of his mother, you are suggesting that his paternity is in question. You need to understand that. Now I'm going to get into that some more tomorrow when I get to Matthew, because Matthew is the one that introduces this story. Magdalene doesn't appear in the story in any of the Gospels except Luke. She doesn't appear until the time of the crucifixion by name. And then she is portrayed as among the mourners in Mark, Matthew, and Luke. She's the only mourner when you get to John. In John's Gospel, there are some very telling stories about Mary. And first of all, she demands of a man she thinks is the gardener, this is John's Gospel, access to the body of the deceased Jesus. That's off the charts inappropriate in Jewish society unless she's the nearest of kin. So that causes some people to wonder whether John was hinting at that. She addresses him as Rabboni. That's an intimate word that would be used by a rabbinic student for a revered rabbi. It would also be used for a woman married to a rabbi, because part of the Jewish world was that you had to revere your husband. Not a bad idea, so long as the husband reveres the wife. Equality in revering is really important. So there are some places. Now, the place about Magdalene, there is no village called Magdala. I don't care if you've been there. They built that village for people just like you. That village was built as a tourist trap to capture some interest from this story. They knew how to say Mary of Magdala, if that's what they had intended. They say Paul of Tarsus, they say Jesus of Nazareth, they say Peter of Bethsaida. But Magdalene is like a title. There are only two places in the New Testament where a title is used. One is Mary Magdalene, and the other is Judas Iscariot. I'll talk about Judas more on Thursday. So what do you do with this title Magdalene? Well, you look in the Hebrew language to see if you can find something that might give you a clue. And you know, in the Hebrew language, vowels are unimportant, so the consonants are what's really important. The consonants in Magdalene are M-D-G-L. So you look for a Hebrew word with those four consonants, and you find one. It's called Migdal. There's a reference to it in the book of Genesis. There's a reference to it in the book of Micah. And it means a tower. The tower of the flocks, the Migdal Eder. And it apparently was a tall structure that the shepherd would climb to get a better view of the flock. And so it became a large structure. And as language changed, perhaps it developed into being a synonym for largeness or even greatness. Maybe Mary Magdalene means the great Mary. And if Magdalene means the great Mary, and the mother of Jesus is named Mary, then you've got to ask what relationship might be greater than the mother of Jesus, and then you come back to the possibility of her being his wife, to put it bluntly. I wrote about that in a book called Born of a Woman some years ago. And I'm still convinced that there's probably a very significant relationship. And I, you know, as a Southern moralist, I hope they were married. But I cannot prove that. That's just speculation. But let me just say to conclude this answer, that the primary reason that I'd like to think that Jesus had a wife named Magdalene is that I think that those people who think that Jesus has to be sexless and without a partner are primarily people who denigrate women, who think women are corrupting presences, who think that women sort of pollute holy men. Now, I'd like to tell you it's an idea I find repulsive. If I have any chance to be holy, it's because I live inside Christine's love. And for anybody to suggest that somehow that's a corrupting or a polluting relationship of male holiness is to me just anathema. And so that's my agenda. And that's why I wrote that book. I wrote that book for my three daughters because I wanted them to see somebody in the life of the church that says something about women that's not denigrating, and we've just done that for far too long. But I can't answer the question.
Thank you.
A gentleman.
Thank you for being here, sir. You spoke earlier in your lesson today about the plagues of Egypt. There is a position taught at Hebrew Union College by Dr. David Aaron that the 10 plagues serve as a polemic against polytheism, that each plague takes away the power of an Egyptian god, for instance, water, the water god, blood, you know, putting blood in the water, things like that, to establish a monotheistic or monolatrist power over it. I wanted to know if you were aware of such a study and what you thought of it.
Yeah, I think that that's another effort to try to make sense out of the plague stories without being literal. And I think that's been if you start out with the Bible as literal and you've got to find a way to make sense out of it and take it out of literalism, I think you do the sort of things that Dr. Aaron does. And I think it's perfectly legitimate. It's more legitimate homiletically, I think, than it is from a point of view of biblical scholarship. But I don't object to that. I wish we could start with the idea that the Bible is a human book trying to give us insights that are beyond the boundaries of our human ability to understand. And then you wouldn't have to sort of deliteralize some parts of it from time to time. I don't want to take any part of it literally. I want to take every verse of it seriously. And I want to engage it. But I don't want to be in the realm of people that think somehow the Bible is the same as God. Only God is holy. Only God is literal. And the Bible points to that God, but the Bible can never exhaust that God or capture that God. Otherwise, what you've created is a idolatry of the Bible, a bibliolatry. And I grew up in that. And when I grew up in that biblical mentality, I was taught that segregation was the will of God and the Bible was quoted to prove it. And I was taught that men were by creation superior to women and the Bible was quoted to prove it. And I was taught that it was okay to hate other religions and especially the Jews and the Bible was quoted to prove it. And I was taught that homosexuals are either mentally sick or morally depraved. They either should be converted or cured and the Bible was quoted to prove it. And I've spent so much of my life trying to work out of all those biblical lessons that I don't want to be caught back in that, and I'm not even going to be terribly applauding of people that want to deliteralize one portion, because I think you ought to deliteralize the whole story so you can get on the inside of it and begin to talk about the Bible the way the Bible is meant to be read and talked about. So I would love to study with your professor from two conversations I've now had with you, and I will be happy to read him, but I wouldn't say that that's getting to the same thing that I'm trying to get to. I think the plagues were part of the Jewish propaganda to justify their rebellion. If you go back to the American Revolution, you'll discover that we had a lot of American propaganda to justify our rebellion against the Brits. But that war is over. My wife was born in Sussex. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
I belong to a tribe called Methodists. And I absorbed something the Reverend Mr. Jones said yesterday. We don't want to give it up. So I'd like to ask you a question. What can I do as a lay person to shake up the Methodist clergy to share what they surely know about the Bible, especially if they went to Emory Candler?
Went to where?
Candler School of Theology.
Well, that's
Emory
one of the better
University.
Methodist schools, in my opinion. Duke, Candler, and Drew are my favorite three of the Methodists.
They're supposed to be the liberal end of Methodist preachers as opposed to Asbury, say.
Yeah, well, I understand. We all have our burdens to bear. Well, let me first respond to you by saying, stop having an inferiority complex about being a layperson. Lay people have enormous power. In the course of my life as a bishop, I probably had about 1,000 clergy that were supposedly under my care. That's a myth that they were ever under my care, but that's the way the rules read it. And what I discovered was that lay people have enormous power, but you've got to learn how to use it.
That's what I want to know.
Comments that are made at the front door are very, very important. And I've had some strange ones. I remember the lady who said, "Mr. Spong, every one of your sermons is better than the next." "Your sermons are like water to a drowning man," they said. But in my experience with clergy, if you've got 100 people in church on Sunday morning and 99 of them come out and say, "Man, that sermon this morning was the best thing since sliced bread," and you come out and you say, "Son," that's always a put down. "Son, you really aren't sharing with us what you know, and I resent it. You're insulting my intelligence." I promise you, the next week, that's all that clergyman's going to think about. He isn't going to think about the 99. He's going to think about you. And if you do that Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, you will watch him grow. Most clergy are scared to share their knowledge because they think there's nobody out there that will appreciate it, and they'll be in trouble. And if you begin to say, "I want it," then he has a consensus to begin to build. And somebody will come and say, "Well, I'm upset that you don't think Jonah was really 3 days in that whale." And he will say, "But I've got this other lady in my church, and she's on my back every single Sunday." And it gives him some leverage. When I was a bishop, I very consciously tried to step out ahead on every issue. Not because I liked the controversy, but because it gave my clergy the assurance that they could step out and they would not be undercut. The tragedy with most leaders in the Christian church is that if the church is here, the leader is right there with him. Sometimes the leader is even back behind the church. And so anytime somebody does something creative, they get their legs chopped off. If you want to be a leader, you've got to step out ahead of where the institution is. You've got to anticipate the future. You've got to hold up a new possibility. I never forget a priest in my diocese who's today the rector of St. John's Church in Lafayette Square, Washington. And every time I see him, he's got his arm around Barack Obama or George Bush as they come out of church together. But he was serving a church in Paterson, New Jersey. And he came up to me one time and he said, "Jack, I sure am glad you're my bishop." And I said, "What a discerning young man you are." And he said, "Yeah, the reason I'm glad is that no matter how wild I am in my sermon, people go out of church and say, 'Well, at least you're not as bad as our bishop.'" And that's enormous clergy freedom. And I'm afraid the biggest problem in the Methodist church, and I must say I admire the Methodist church a lot, but the biggest problem is the willingness of their clergy leaders to take public stands and take the heat for it. There are some great Methodists. I think of two in Arizona, Jeff Proctor Murphy and David Felton, who produced this thing called Living the Questions. I think that's an enormous contribution to adult education. And they've had to fight the hierarchy. Those guys ought to be honored. They ought to be extolled as the virtue of the picture of virtue in Methodist ministry. And instead, they've got to always fight because the bishop gets letters from somebody that says, "I'm upset." Well, write it back and say, "I'm sorry." And go on about your business. But anyway, thank you for your question.
I've written my bishop.
Well, work on your local pastor. Do I see a man? You get a turn. You're next, and then I'll come to you.
Thank you. That's the first time as a man I ever got put forward. I am a rabbi, and I want to express my appreciation of your appreciation of the prophets. I have difficulty with two things, though. One is, I think you'd have a hard time finding in the verse in the book of Exodus, wherever it says that God hates the Egyptians. The one verse it does says is you're not allowed, Lotet Ta'ev, you're not allowed to abhor the Egyptians. The second thing, which is right in line of you, the Jewish practice on the holiday of Passover sings 6 psalms of praise to God for the victory in Egypt. But because the Egyptians were drowned, they don't say a full praise, they say an abbreviated praise, because how could you totally praise God if somebody was killed while you were being saved?
Yep.
And that seems to me reflect the spirit of Exodus, and therefore Exodus, much of it, is in light of your analysis of much of the rest of the prophets.
Well, the rabbis have had lots of years to work on Exodus and clean it up, and I appreciate the fact that they've done that. I find it really difficult to think that God can kill the firstborn male in every Egyptian household and still not hate Egyptians. I don't care what the exegesis finally works out. So I think the actions speak for themselves. But what's important to me is not that. Because the fact is that every people had a tribal god. Every people thought they were chosen. The Edomites thought they were chosen by their god, and the Moabites thought they were chosen. And we've associated the idea of being the chosen people just with the Jews, primarily because the Christians have honed into the Jewish sacred story and have made it our own. And we suggested in the process that God has now rejected the Jews and just has accepted us Christians as the chosen people. I think all chosen people ideas are seriously flawed. If God has a chosen people, it's the whole universe. And that's what I think we've got to get to. But I appreciate the words.
That Exodus does not say that God hates the Egyptians.
I understand that. It's a very important point. It just has God acting in a hateful way toward the Jews. And you can still you can play that any way you want to.
Anyhow, thank you for the appreciative analysis.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
To digress just a little bit, you were talking about how women were depicted in our Judeo-Christian tradition, but you didn't mention Lilith and her role as Adam's first wife in Hebrew mythology. Is that the beginning? Lilith? Lilith?
Lilith. No, I don't want to mention Lilith. You know, I just don't think that's very important.
All right.
I think that's another attempt. Anybody here know about Lilith? How many know about Lilith? It's not what you'd call mainstream. It's a way of trying to suggest that Adam had more than one wife, and I just, you know, there's some things that are outside the boundaries of my interest, and that's one of them. I got to go over here. These last two, we wind up with two women.
Well, that wasn't my question, but I'll add on to her. That might be helpful for a lot of people who look at the Adam and Eve story and use it as a means of denigrating homosexuality as Adam and Eve being the model of God's plan for marriage. But yep. That's not my question.
Okay, well, that's good. Because I'm not interested. I'm sort of tired of listening to it wasn't Adam and Eve, it was Adam and Steve. That just doesn't make much sense to me. Go ahead.
I agree, but it might blow some holes in their story. My question is, I saw an essay on Facebook by you about, is an interfaith future possible in our world, based on a think tank experience you had here at Chautauqua about interfaith compatibility.
It's already on Facebook?
Yes.
That's amazing. It just came out last Thursday.
Isn't that awesome?
I got to Facebook.
I must have read it that day. Anyway, you said in that that it wasn't quite as rosy and hopeful as one might hope. You tended to think that it was only possible if we all came to an equality understanding of other faiths. And seeing as we're having trouble with so many other issues of equality still, and yet with race and women and gender, is there any hope for that?
So, I'm not sure I still know what your question is.
Can you speak to the possibility of an interfaith compatibility as we go forward for peace in the world?
I'll try to do that briefly. About a week ago, Joan convened, how many, 40 people up here? 50 people of various religious traditions, Hindus, Buddhists, Catholics, Protestants, Jewish people, academics, rabbis, professors, to talk about whether we can self-consciously step into a larger picture of interfaith activity in this place. It was an exciting conference. And I've written 2 columns on it. One came out last Thursday at 2 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and the second one will come out this Thursday at 2 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. I hope you'll all wake up so you can get it hot off the press. But it'll save till Thursday morning whenever you wake up. And the second one is far more, all I did in that first one was sort of describe Chautauqua and the issue and the problem. And I've offered in the one that comes out next week an insight into at least how I can view the inner faith future. And I talked about that a little bit yesterday in the dialogue with Mr. Rosenblatt. Because I think the block, the thing that makes interfaith activity almost impossible, is that every religion claims that it has the truth. You know, in the Catholic tradition, you have an infallible pope. Protestants try to claim an inerrant Bible. Almost every religious group I know tries to claim that it alone controls the access to salvation. No one comes to the Father but by my religious tradition. Everybody has some claims they are the true faith. And when you enter into a dialogue and somebody claims the truth, it makes the dialogue almost impossible. I remember when I was the Bishop of Newark, we were engaged in interfaith dialogue, and I'd meet with my Roman Catholic counterpart. His name was Ted McCarrick. He later became the Cardinal Archbishop of Washington. A very fascinating man, very bright man. But we'd start the discussion, and he would say, well, we're happy to discuss anything in the interfaith arena except those things on which the Pope has made a pronouncement. Well, I didn't know of anything else I wanted to talk about. And I want to talk about the role of women in the church. I want to talk about whether abortion in all instances is evil. I wanted to talk about whether priests could be married. Now, those were important issues to me. They're important issues to women. And if we can't talk about anything that the Pope's already pronounced on, then there's no reason to have dialogue. So I think we've got to get to the place where we can affirm our truth but recognize that it is not ultimate. And I tried to say it yesterday by saying that I'm a Christian, but I don't think God is. And I don't think God's a Jew, and I don't think God's a Muslim, and I don't think God's a Buddhist, and I don't think God's a Hindu. But I think Christianity, Judaism, Hinduism, Islam, and Buddhism are human creations which enable millions of people to walk into the mystery of God. And you can't walk all paths at once. You have to walk a path. You have to walk the path of your life and your hope and your tradition. But I believe if I walk deeply enough into my Christian faith, I will transcend the limits of Christianity, because I don't think Christianity can bind God. And the last thing I ever want to do is to tell God who is acceptable to God. I find that just incredible, that anybody would think they could instruct God on who God can love and who God can accept. And I hope by the time I get to the end of this week, I'll show you that that's the essence of the kind of Christianity that I think has a chance to live in the future. So write me after. My column has a way you can write me, and I do get it. It goes to Seattle, but it finally comes to me. And if I haven't answered your question when the second one comes out, and Joan hadn't even seen the second one. I hope we'll get it to her, but they won't let anybody, they embargo them until they send them out, so I'm not supposed to ever send my column to anybody before it's printed. But anyway, if I haven't addressed your question, but that's the general way. Thank you for your question. I'll try to be very brief with our last question.
So
and then I'd love to talk to the Lilith person privately.
So your discussion of the role of women in the church and reminded me of the Da Vinci Code. And Dan Brown is talking about this occult suppressing the role of women in the church. Dan Brown was here last year. I heard him, and he was very interesting. We understood from his family life his view of religion and integration of religion and science, and his rather almost blasphemous view of Christianity. So I wonder what you thought of the Da Vinci Code and the concept of the suppression of female deity and female role in the church.
Well, I'm certainly not an expert on Dan Brown. I think he's an incredible writer. and a fantastic storyteller. That's a page turner. How many of you have actually read the Da Vinci Code? See? God, that's just incredible. I don't think he's a great theologian. I don't think he's a great biblical scholar, but he is a great storyteller. And the idea that part of the DNA of Jesus has gone from first century to a woman living in France is very hypothetical. And, and even if it had, it would be such a minuscule amount of DNA that it'd be insignificant. I find the same thing in that wonderful story in the Gospel of Luke that says all the descendants of King David had to go back to Bethlehem to be enrolled. There were 55 generations between King David and the time of Jesus, and David probably had as many as 300 wives. By the time you got to Jesus, he would have had over 1 billion direct descendants. And who kept records? And if all those people had to go to Bethlehem, it's no wonder there was no room in the inn. And that's when the stories became so fantastic, you know they weren't meant to be literal. One final story, because I just love the birth narratives, and it was Rosemary Ruther, a Roman Catholic lay theologian, who read that story, which says that Joseph took Mary, who was great with child, up to Bethlehem. The only way he could have gotten her there was on a donkey or by walking. And Rosemary Ruther said, what man in his right mind is going to take an 8.5 to 9 month pregnant woman on a 94-mile donkey ride from Nazareth to Bethlehem? And then she went on to say, only a man who's never had a baby could have written that story. But you see, that's why treating the Bible literally can be reduced to nonsense. And for us to spend our time debating whether it's literally true means we won't spend any time trying to understand why it's really true and what the truth is. And the truth is always in metaphor. The truth is never in factuality. Indeed, in the Gospel of Luke, it says that this census took place when Quirinius was governor of Syria. But we can go to secular records today, and we can find that Quirinius didn't become governor of Syria until Jesus had to be somewhere between 10 and 11 years old. So the story breaks down literally on all kinds of points. But maybe the story is designed to say that there's something about Jesus of Nazareth that we don't believe human life by itself could ever have created. That's the experience they're trying to talk about. And I think that's a valid experience. Well, I've loved being with you, and I'll see you tomorrow.